Harper Audio presents North of Normal, a memoir of my wilderness childhood, my unusual family, and how I survived both, by Cea Sunrise Person. This is the author. For Mom, who taught me how to focus on the positive and banish fear to the dungeon of useless emotions. November's winds are keen and cold, as brownies know who roam the world and have no home to which to run when they have had their night of fun. But cunning hands are never slow to build a fire of ruddy glow. Palmer Cox, Brownie Yearbook. Author's note. This is the story of my life. Most of the memories depicted here are my own, but I have also drawn on the memories of my mother, grandparents, aunts, and father. My early life was a complicated jumble of events that was difficult to put into order, even for my family, but I have done my best. Timelines may not be exact, and dialogue and settings have obviously been recreated in the interest of storytelling. I have also omitted certain events in my life that were not significant to this memoir. Some names, distinguishing features, and locations have been changed to protect certain individuals. Prologue. I rolled over in bed, reaching for the warmth of my mother under the bearskin blanket. She wrapped her arms around me, and I pulled Susie doll into my chest so we were three spoons. The birds were just starting to call. Through the teepee poles above, I could see a patch of lightening sky. Any moment now, our canvas walls would begin to turn from gray to orange. It was the time of day I liked best, because it was the start of everything. "Mommy," I whispered. "Shh, still sleeping." I turned to look at her, then placed a finger on each eyelid and pulled them up. "Mommy, is this the day Papa Dick gets back from hunting?" "Maybe," she mumbled, batting my hand away. "Now go back to sleep." I lay quietly beside her, but I was too excited to keep still. It had been a long winter. The meat from my grandfather's last big hunt had run out long ago, and he had promised he would try to get a bear, my favorite. My feet jiggled back and forth under the covers. I finally got them to stop, but then my fingers started to twitch. I drummed them on Mom's hip. "Mm-mm," she said, putting her hand on top of mine. "Cea, if you can't sleep, why don't you go start the fire? Heat up the footstone for me. It's cold this morning." I lifted the bearskin and reached for the heavy rock. Wrapped in one of my grandfather's old wool shirts, it smelled like smoke and pine needles. I set it down beside the stove and pulled my clothes on. Turtleneck, sweater, cords, and leather moccasins. The summer before, one of the visitor's daughters had shown me something called underwear. They had tiny rainbows on them, and they were the most beautiful things I'd ever seen. Mom said I could have a pair one day, probably when I was 5. But right now, I was still just 4. Mom was snoring lightly. I crept across our fir needle floor, lifted the canvas door flap, and stepped outside. It was no colder out here than it was in the teepee, but a breeze made goosebumps pop up on my skin. I hurried across the meadow to the shit pit and dropped my pants, peering down at the massive pile of poop beneath me as I peed. After zipping my pants, I slid the cover back over the pit and skipped over to my grandparents' teepee, stood quietly outside. I could tell by Grandma Jean's breathing that she was still asleep, but there was another sound coming from my aunt's teepee a little further down. I walked toward it, my moccasins skimming over the dewy grass, and peeked inside. My Aunt Jessie was asleep in her bed with her mouth wide open, but across from her, my Aunt Jan was doing the screwing with the guy visitor. She was sitting on top of him, her long blonde hair hanging over her breasts in sweaty strings. I gazed at them curiously, wondering where the visitor's woman was. Mom said it usually wasn't a good idea to do the screwing with a visitor who had a woman, but my aunts didn't seem to mind. Maybe the woman was looking for her cat, which had disappeared yesterday. Anyway, Grandma Jean said that lady was awfully silly for bringing her city cat all the way to the wilderness like that. I was starting to shiver. In the distance, I could hear the rush of the river, finally set free from its winter freeze. The sun was peeking over the top of the highest mountain now, flooding our meadow with orange light. I headed toward the woodpile, thinking that I would build the fire and then ask Mom to make hot porridge with prunes for breakfast. I picked up a log, but was distracted by the sight of one of my stick horses propped against the sawhorse along with my bow and arrow. Dropping the log back onto the woodpile, I mounted my horse, threw my bow over my shoulder, and galloped across the meadow. "Giddy up, Apache," I yelled, whipping the leather rein behind me. Randall, the Indian chief who lived across the river, had told me that word meant go really fast in horse language, and my horse always listened. He circled me around the meadow and then headed for the forest, almost bucking me off. Branches tugged at my sleeves, snagging at my sweater as we ran, but my horse wouldn't stop. He kept going until we got to Porcupine Tree. I pulled back the reins and slipped off his back, gazing upward with my hand shading my eyes. It was dark in the woods, but the sky was bright. And Porcupine was exactly where I had left him yesterday, snoozing high up on a branch. "Crotch," I said to myself quietly. "Crotch, crotch, crotch," I giggled. Mom said that was what that part of the tree was called, right where the branch met the trunk, and I thought it was super funny. I reached for my bow and arrow, but then stopped. Papa Dick had told me that unless you were starving, you should never kill an animal when it was sleeping, because it just wasn't fair. I looked around for a rock and pitched it at the tree trunk with a loud whack. The porcupine shook and snapped its head up. I set my arrow and pulled back my bow. It was a miss, but closer than I'd come yesterday. I scrounged around in the bushes until I found the arrow, then mounted my horse again and pointed it home. I couldn't wait to tell Papa Dick. He had said that if I kept practicing every day, pretty soon I'd be allowed to go hunting with him. After corralling my horse with a circle of rocks, I returned to the woodpile and loaded my arms with kindling. Back in our teepee, I built a fire from the embers in the stove, placed the footstone in the flames, and waited for it to heat up. Then I carefully pulled it out with oven mitts, wrapped it up in the wool shirt, and rolled it over to the bed. "Thank you, sweetheart," Mom said with her eyes still closed, and opened her arms for me. I snuggled into her naked body, and she kissed my hair. After a little while, I decided to stop being so excited about Papa Dick maybe coming home, tucked my head under Mom's chin, and fell fast asleep. The sun was just starting to hide behind the teepee when I saw him. I was playing in the dirt, mixing it with water to paint on rocks when I spotted Papa Dick across the meadow. I jumped up and ran full speed until I slammed into his arms. "Peanut," he cried, spinning me around in circles. I laughed and buried my face in his bushy hair. My eyes fell to the wheeled sled he was pulling behind him, brimming with chunks of bloody meat wrapped in wax paper. "Did you get a bear? Did you get a bear?" "Aha! Now that's a surprise. What do you say we get Grandma Jean to cook some up and see if you can guess what it is?" "Hooray!" I squirmed out of his arms and bolted for my grandparents' teepee, calling for my grandmother. "Grandma Jean, Papa got meat. Let's cook some up." She came out of the teepee smiling and ran to my grandfather. They hugged and kissed, Grandma Jean so happy she had tears running down her cheeks. My Aunt Jessie and Aunt Jan came out of their teepee and then Mom, and we were all hugging and laughing. "Geez, you'd think I'd been gone a month instead of just a few days," Papa Dick said, but I could tell he was pleased. The late afternoon sun was warm on my head. The birds were singing, and Grandma Jean was in such a good mood that she put Van Morrison on the tape deck, even though Papa Dick said there was only a little bit of juice left in the battery. We all boogied in the meadow to moon dance. Mom rolled a joint and passed it around. And my grandmother heated up the iron skillet and fried up some of the meat in caribou fat. I took one bite, then jumped up to give my grandfather a hug. It's Bear! It's Bear! Oh, thank you, Papa Dick. When I went to bed that night, I was so full and happy that I didn't even care when Mom and Randall woke me up later. I rolled to the edge of the bed and faced the teepee wall, pretending the grunts and groans were just part of a dream, and that really it was just Mom and me lying in bed, snuggled up all warm in the dying light of the kerosene lantern. Part 1. Dream. Chapter 1. The story that is the life I now reflect on began with my grandfather, Richard Abel Person. His history is likely even more interesting than my own, but I only know tidbits of it. Born in Duluth, Minnesota, to Swedish immigrant parents, he seemed to come into this world knowing his passion. When he was just a boy, he began taking to the woods behind his family's house to practice building campfires and setting handmade snares that brought down rabbits for his family's dinner. By the time he was 16, he had memorized nearly every edible plant in North America and had taught himself how to climb, fish, and hunt with both rifle and bow and arrow. He could build a weatherproof shelter from tree branches and twine and paddle through stormy waters with a coffee mug clenched between his knees. Even early on, he knew he wasn't long for the urban life. When he walked the streets of his hometown, the concrete beneath his feet offended him. Sometimes he dreamed of escaping to a much different world altogether. But then he met my grandmother, and she gave him reason to stay. Jean was 19 years old when she first met Dick, who was 3 years younger. She was sitting on the grass at the local pool where she worked as a lifeguard, eating lunch with a girlfriend. His moccasined feet stopped in front of her. She lifted her eyes to meet his, and that was it. For my grandmother, meeting Dick wasn't just finding a kindred spirit. It was also a welcome distraction from reality. Her parents had divorced when she was 11. And not much later, Jean's mother had suffered a stroke that left half her body paralyzed. It fell to Jean, the only child, to run her family's bakery. She would wake each morning before sunrise, go to the bakery to work, walk the 3 miles to school, return to the bakery to help her mother until closing time, and fall into bed each night exhausted. And now that she was finished with school, between her bakery and lifeguard jobs, her days seemed an endless cycle of work. When she could get away, she would go to the forest to walk alone, sometimes wishing to get lost among the hills and valleys. My grandparents courted for 3 years before marrying, and both of them were certain that there was no other love quite like theirs in the world. It was a love affair not just with each other, but with the rivers and trees and animals of the wild. Nature fed their souls and gave them purpose. On the day of their wedding, Jean was walking to City Hall to meet Dick when she got her period. Dismayed when it left an unsightly stain on the back of her fancy tweed skirt, she returned home and changed into a pair of jeans. And this was how she was dressed an hour later when she stood in front of her mother, stepfather, and Dick's parents to exchange vows. Her mother despaired at her lack of formality, but Jean secretly thought it was the perfect outfit for the occasion and a true symbol of her relationship with her husband. They spent their honeymoon fishing and hiking around Lake Superior. My grandfather helped steady Jean's hands on the rifle as she fired her first bullet at a moose, felling it with one clean shot to the head. My grandparents discussed ways they might live close to nature and still earn a living, and Dick decided on a career in forestry. He joined the army to get a free university education, but a war was raging in Korea, and within a year he found himself fighting in the trenches of Incheon. He wrote letters home to Jean, telling of his anger with the U.S. government. Here he was battling against communism, he lamented, when he wasn't even sure he believed in capitalism, along with his unexpected enjoyment of an existence that challenged the most basic elements of human nature. He was sleeping in the rain and eating live crickets right off the ground, things that his fellow soldiers loathed, but that made Dick feel strangely alive, as if he were actually thriving in such an environment rather than merely surviving. He had long debates about the state of the American psyche with his comrades. "Folks don't own houses," he loved to say. "Houses own folks. Once you're beholden to an institute of finance, you may as well just put yourself in prison and throw away the key for good." Dick's friends listened to his rants, but he understood that most of his words fell on deaf ears. And that was okay, because he had his wife back at home, the woman who he knew would stay up knitting wool socks for him while he talked to her about everything that mattered. After he returned from Korea, disillusioned with American values but otherwise unharmed, Dick completed his university degree and took a job as a forest ranger. "It was an occupation that kept my grandparents broke and rootless, sending them from Minnesota to Washington and Missouri, all within the span of a year, but neither of them really minded. They lived simply and were able to unpack their belongings at each new home within a few hours. Before long, the babies came, Jan, Michelle, Dane, and then Jessie. Shortly after Jessie's birth, she was proclaimed mentally retarded, but by that time, my grandmother..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.